get your responses to that. And I was, Sharita, watching your face throughout.
Yeah.
Because you are very expressive.
I am, yes. I've been told not to play poker. Yeah. So,
any first thoughts?
Well, the first thoughts that I have is a while ago, I did some research on trust, specifically online trust. And one of the things that I thought about and one of the things that I read that was fairly new as opposed to, let's say, 30, 40 years old view on how trust was formed was that empathy was really one of the antecedents of trust. That if you could communicate empathy in an environment, let's say, where you don't have a face or whatever, it tended to begin the process of trust. So what's going around in my mind then is if care is somehow involved with some kind of empathy, some kind of empathic behavior, and that in a way is connected to trust, is the duty of care somehow related to trust in a situation? Does that make any sense? I know I'm skipping something.
Well, it makes sense to me. Again, you know, I'm coming at this as the analytic philosopher. So it sounds like, you know, to me, it sounds like a causal chain from trust and perhaps trust forming mechanisms to this connection to create empathy, which in turn leads to or is part of care. Does that sound like a characterization?
Sort of. Yeah, sort of. I mean, I look at trust and empathy as a chicken and egg kind of thing, in that they revolve around each other. And if you were to take that frame, then in what you are looking at care.
Yeah.
Or another entity.
So that's interesting. Let me throw a rock into your pond.
Okay. That's
fine. So I'm a devotee, less so now than I used to be, of something called fail videos. And you might not know what fail videos are. Certainly a lot of the viewers won't. Basically, a fail video is when somebody tries to do something and fails.
Spectacularly.
I actually sat down a while back and tried to think, to myself, what are the components of a good fail video, right? Because there's lots of failure out there in the world, but a good fail video will include the spectacular element. Sometimes the best ones include, an element that's unexpected, right? And that's where the fail website has actually begun to, if you will, fail me recently, and why I'm less interested now. There's any number of people on a skateboard sliding down the rail, losing their balance, and landing with the rail right between their legs. Mm-hmm. Right. That's a fail. Now, that gets me because when they do that, I go, oh, right. So, and that I attribute to empathy, right? More accurately, that seems to me to be a feeling of empathy, right? Mm-hmm. And the more spectacular and the more unusual the fail, the more I'm inclined to feel this sort of empathy. I'm trying to think of an unexpected way of failing. It's like they slide down the rail, everything's perfect. I'm expecting them to lose their balance, but no, they land, they're rolling along, and then a car hits them. That's unexpected. Or I saw a video just yesterday, person standing or on their bike or in their car or whatever, they're looking at an intersection and you see the two cars approach each other. There's a collision. One of them goes flipping off the side of the screen. Wait, two beats. Then another car sort of rolls along with the flipping car on top of it. Now, I didn't feel so much empathy there because I didn't see any people. All I'm seeing are cars. But anyhow, the rock in the pond part of this is there's no trust anywhere here. I'm watching these things, and when they're well done, I'm having this feeling of, oh, no. And that feeling to me seems to be the empathy. Would that make me trust them more? No, it would make me trust them less. But that's not to disagree with what you're saying. But it is to suggest that there might be varieties of empathy.
Yeah.
I hadn't thought of that. Hang on, let me look that up quickly. Hey, why not? It might be another database setup. Varieties of empathy. Let's see if anyone has thought of that before. Of course they have, right? Okay, so we have in a website called theskillsyouneed.com, which is promoted by Google, apparently. There are three types of empathy. Cognitive, emotional, and compassionate.
Ah.
So maybe the one that I'm talking about is emotional and the one that you're talking about is compassionate. And I'm not sure what cognitive empathy would even look like, but...
Don't know.
Yeah, we'd have to look it up. I'm not going to spend our video looking things up on
Google, So that may be, a way of looking at it.
And then there's this whole thing about mirror neurons. So mirror neurons.
Mirror neurons, cool.
So just a quick... quoting from some U.S. government site. Okay. Mirror neurons are a class of neuron that modulate their activity both when an individual executes a specific motor act and when they observe the same or similar act performed by another individual. So I guess the idea here is, and that's consistent with what I've read before. The idea is that when you do something and have a feeling, that creates, that stimulates neurons in the head. Like, for example, right now I'm feeling a little pain from that, which was actually a bit unexpected. Then if you were to do the same thing, and I would observe you, some, although certainly not all, of the neurons in my head that reacted to when I did this would react when you did this, producing presumably similar feelings. And so the theory is that that's the basis for empathy, are these similar feelings produced when you have, or when you do something, or you have an experience similar to when I produce something, when I do something or have a feeling. So maybe, Mirror neurons certainly seem to be a thing. And it's not surprising that they would occur because it, at the very least, the visual perception is similar. So why wouldn't some of the neural reactions be similar? Do they tie into thing and can we found an ethics on them is, I think, a bit of a different story.
Empathy also has to do when you're doing therapy, if you mirror somebody's emotions, or if you mirror, you know, through words, show your understanding, empathy of what a person goes through. That's one of the ways that you establish a relationship with the other person, right?
Good point.
So, and that's considered being empathetic. And in many ways, you're trained to do that. When you're doing certain forms of therapy. And that in turn, mirroring motion. And that in some turn, I think relates to the building of trust.
I'm not sure where I've seen this, but I've heard of this being used, believe it or not, by pickup artists in bars.
Yes, I totally would believe that. Sure.
Yeah.
It's a form of manipulation, really. So.
Oh yeah, it absolutely is.
Yeah.
So I wonder if ethics is based on manipulation. That's an interesting thought.
Well, it is supposed to be the opposite, but in my view.
Well, it is those manipulators that keep telling us what ethics we're supposed to be following.
Yeah.
Politicians.
Yeah, so it's not that ethics is completely free of the concept of manipulation. I know the concept under the heading of active listening.
Yes, okay.
And again, the idea of active listening is you listen to what they said and then you repeat back, not their words, but your own interpretation of what they said, which is sort of what I'm doing here. of course, that can be misused too. I was reading an article just the other day about how to do this when somebody is suffering from depression or whatever, and the instinct on the part of a lot of people is to say, oh yeah, I know how you feel, I've gone through the same thing, and I felt blah 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 blah, which of course is exactly the wrong thing to do, because you probably don't know how they feel, although we feel like we know how they feel, don't we? At least I do. But, you know, I think a lot of myself, so that might be mistaken. What do you think of all this, Mark? Does this make sense to you?
Well, it makes sense. But, you know, I'm going to throw a pebble in your pond, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You sort of drove by biological determinism.
Zip which, right by it.
Yeah. Yeah. Which is good. But you brought in the conversation. So I just wanted to share that I immediately thought, why do men have nipples? So I did want to drop that into your determinism. And you used a man for your example of a feminist theory. So, but well, yeah, I understand. You even commented on it. But,
yeah.
So there's that.
Badly about it.
Yeah, no, I understand. So anyway, those were just, you know, what, that's just me being me. As far as artificial intelligence and analytics and empathy, that's where I hit the wall. You know, and again, with your mirror neurons, you know, another, you know, more neurological determinism, you know, not that, I mean, it is true. And I've always used it. I always thought it was the basis of learning more than empathy, you know, monkey see, monkey do kind of thing. I never thought of it in terms of empathy, so I will think about that. But based on our prior discussions, I mean, you've convinced me that AI is unstoppable and ethics are, I shouldn't use the word infinite, ethics have nothing to do with the spread of AI. And so then my question, and I question whether technology can be used in an empathetic way. As someone who's been using way too much technology, way too much of my time for way too long, to me, it seems to inhibit empathy. And, you know, it's a problem everybody's working on. I took Mahabali's class last summer. She co-taught with Mia Zamora at Digital Pedagogy Labs.
Oh, very good.
And, you know, we talked about the duty of care a bit, but we certainly, in my opinion, didn't make any progress on how we can use this technology to provide care to, in that case, to students or colleagues. I just, so that's where I'm stuck. So there's, that's what I have to say. I'm sort of stuck in how AI or digital technology in general can promote care, it seems to me to inhibit.
And I think that's, that reflects a dominant trend in the literature overall. I mean, go through any number of writers. I was, Donald Clark just referenced Jaron Lanier. I've forgotten how to pronounce the name. Oh, dang. I'm so terrible with names. Sorry, I'm just looking it up. That's not him. Jaron. Dang. Here it is. Jaron. I think it's just Lanier. L-A-N-I-E-R. Jaron. J-A-R-O-N. I know him especially from the video series All Wrapped Up in Machines of Loving Grace.
Right. Oh, that's a blast from the past. Yes.
Oh, wait. That wasn't him, though. That was someone else.
No, that was...
Curry?
Could be. And
Lanier, though, advances arguments along a similar vein.
But that documentary film, though, is...
It was terrific.
Yeah.
All watched over by Machines of Loving Grace. It was by Adam Curtis.
That's it.
Yeah. Terrific series.
All of his films are dark and terrific.
So, but I mean, it's, you know, I think it's an empirical question still. I think that because the machines are still under development, we don't actually know whether they could be empathetic and caring. It would sure be nice if they could, because that's way better than the alternative, you know, in which machines are uncaring and dystopian and interact with us along the lines of machine guns on robot dogs, right? You know, which is not a caring relationship. But
that's
yeah,
my position as well. And I constantly say we're at the very beginning of this. I mostly work in distance and higher education. And so I have to keep saying we're at the very beginning of this. And the culture has to adapt. But unfortunately, our tiptoe through ethics has made me a little less positive than when I arrived. And I wasn't all that positive to begin with. So this is, you know, so that's where I'm at so far in the course. I'm hoping to turn it around here and to see how the culture can mitigate the negative effects and promote the positive effects.
Yeah.
But then you did bring up power. And here we are, you know, in a very hierarchical capitalist system.
Yeah.
And it's a small group of people that control the direction of this, of these machines and how they evolve. And that's very worrisome.
Can we, I mean, we can teach people to have the outward behavior and appearance of empathy. We can teach people to have that. So given that there, you know, given machine learning, given that it at this point starts from some kind of human involvement, can we not teach machines to be empathic?
Well,
at least in terms of behavior.
Appear to be.
I was going to ask, right? Yeah, when we teach people to be empathic, we're teaching the overt behaviors.
Mm-hmm.
Does it follow that they eventually feel empathic? And that's not. That's
an argument in psychology where it says, yes, you can do that.
Yeah. Right? And that argument has been made. There are some pretty good sources for that. William James,
mm-hmm.
Principles of Psychology, suggests that this is what happens as well. Soren Kierkegaard, from a religious context, talks about taking a leap of faith.
Yeah.
And the idea is that if you practice your faith over time, you will come to believe your faith. And I think that we can see that empirically, at least in the sense of, you know, people report that this happens, that they do something, they create a habit or whatever, and then they begin to have the feelings associated with that habit. So arguably that could happen with empathy. Would that happen if we taught a machine that way? Or are feelings intrinsic to human embodiment? But then again, could there be a machine embodiment that's just as good?
Yeah.
But
do either of you know anybody on the autism spectrum personally?
No. And well, although that said, I wouldn't know if I did. Yeah. I work in a research center full of scientists. Mm. Odds are pretty good that I do.
Yeah. I was gonna say that. Yeah.
Yeah. So I have known a couple of people on the spectrum,
mm-hmm.
and they work very hard to appear empathetic and engaged and caring and, you know.
Yeah.
But they have to talk themselves into it. Even I've known people in their 60s. Of course, there was no such thing as a scale when they were children. The one I'm speaking of actually is a very good scientist. But she, even in her 60s, has to constantly remind herself.
Mm-hmm.
to present in an acceptable way.
Mm-hmm.
So based on my experience, I'm doubtful that a machine would learn anything that we would call empathy. Now, behavior, we can modify. Mm-hmm. So then that gets back to trust. So as someone who's worked with machines their whole life, I do not trust machines. Nope. From taking apart my Volkswagen as a teenager to working in one of the most advanced technological glass blowing facilities in Sonoma. Mm-hmm. It only got, as I moved up in the technology world, it only got more different to humans.
Mm-hmm.
So that one, you're going to have a real hard time convincing me of. Machines are faster and stronger and heavier. And then you get down to the real simple things. If a machine falls on you, you are dead. That's it. Mm-hmm. Story ends.
Well, depends on the machine. And
if it's,
but I know what you mean.
Yeah, if it's an order of magnitude heavier than you, that's it. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, yeah, that's the thing. There's no negotiating. There's no, you know, it's over. And I worked with electricity, explosive gases, and I met people that have been damaged by technology. So even though I spent my whole life in technology, it's dangerous, you know. And now I thought I was doing a good thing helping you make computer chips. Now I realize it was way more dangerous than I ever imagined. So that's part of my skeptical attitude. Unfortunately, I have. It's not popular in some sense.
Well, it's funny, we could make the leap from what you've just said to saying something like machines are malicious and evil. And that's a leap people wouldn't have nearly as much difficulty making.
True. Well, when you give them artificial intelligence, then you can start making those kind of arguments.
Yeah.
I was just talking about physics, but now if you're talking about artificial intelligence, robot quadrupeds, I'm not going to call them dogs.
Yeah.
you know,
I can't resist.
Yeah.
I know. And that's why they use the term, because it's irresistible.
Yeah, I know.
You know, and we don't talk enough about dominating cultures and propaganda and all that, because that's what goes through my mind when I hear anybody talk in higher education, politics. I even went to church as a class project, virtually, as a class project, something I haven't done in 50, 60 years. And as people talk, I just, my little bit of education is in sociology. And I'm like, what is this person trying to do with this group? And I just can't get away from that now. Now that I got that in my head, I'm just constantly critical of groups.
There's a bunch of threads that we can tug at this week.
Yeah.
And we will. I've got 12:57 here, so I'm just sort of moving into wrap-up mode. I'm sorry, because this was a pretty good discussion, and I want it to go on for a long time. But at least we have Friday again to revisit some of this. I'm going to look especially at some of the ethics of care philosophers, people like Carol Gilligan, Nell Noddings, and others, and talk about how that influences our topic. And even if we can't make our machines love us, and even if they only hate us, I think there's some interesting things we'll be able to say. And I'm not trying to convince you that machines will care for us. Like I say, I still think that's an open question. Mm-hmm. But the interesting question here is, how would we know? What are the criteria, if we can even speak in those terms, of caring for us? How would we know if a machine cares for us or not? And does it matter if they do the right sort of thing? And even more to the point, what lessons can we draw from this discussion of care with respect to the wider topic? How does it inform us about, what are ethics in terms of analytics and AI with respect to learning? I know there are some things that we can learn from it, but again, we have to look at that to see what it is. So I'll have more videos. I apologize at the same time I make a promise. I'm also going to be including more readings in the newsletter so that you're not dependent on my videos. And I think that's something I should have been doing from the start, which I haven't been doing. And as well, I'll try to improve some of the activities that the course offers. They've been pretty lame so far. Although I've been trying, but I think there are things that I can do But we'll see how that goes. It all depends on time, of course. If you have suggestions or ideas, by all means. And certainly, you know, I encourage you to blog some thoughts about how care ties into ethics and learning analytics specifically. I think that would be helpful. Certainly, this discussion's been very helpful to me already. So that's a good start. Any last words before I close off the recording? No. All right. Well, it was good to see you and talk to you both again. Thanks for joining me.